Well, good afternoon, everyone. The Australian economy is fighting back. The jobs of Australians depend on that fight. The incomes of Australians depend on that fight, and we are in it. And we are making progress. Doesn't mean we don't have setbacks. We are currently experiencing some right now. The unemployment figures that released just within the last hour have been for June. In July, I expect that we'll see impact from what is occurring in Victoria. But what it has demonstrated in June, that as Australia has opened up again, as people have gone back into their businesses and opened their doors, as Australians have been endeavouring to live with this virus and to press on, then we've seen Australians get back into work, and this has been a core objective of our approach over these past many months, and it remains the focus of our approach, together with managing the health situation in Victoria and other states as outbreaks and other challenges emerge. Of particular importance in the figures that we've seen today is that of the 210,000 jobs added in June, 60% of the jobs regained were for women, and 50% of the jobs regained were for youth. Underemployment has fallen, and we've seen an improvement in hours. The majority of jobs, obviously, were in part-time employment, not in full-time employment. That's to be expected in the economic situation that we've seen emerge over these many months. But what I'm encouraged by about that is the flexibility that we've seen in the labour force has meant that it's been able to keep people in jobs. Maybe not as many hours as they once had, but they're still in jobs. And even better, the people who were working alongside them are also still in a job because of those flexible arrangements that have been in place for employers to keep more and more people on. Now, these are not ordinary times, still by a long shot. And the government's responses, both in our thinking and the measures that we've delivered, have certainly not been ordinary. We must continue to adopt this approach as we deal with the virus, as it impacts us here in Australia, as indeed it impacts around the world. We've got to deal with what's in front of us each and every day, as we are with the situation in particular in Victoria, but as well as in New South Wales, where I've been in constant contact with the premiers and the health officials in recent days, as is our normal practice. But we've also got a plan for the way ahead. We have delivered much needed support over these many months through a raft of programs: JobSeeker, JobKeeper, HomeBuilder, the important programs we've put in for the entertainment sector most recently, the supports we've provided in the childcare sector, the supports that we've provided with the cash flow assistance to businesses. Right across the board, we have been providing the necessary supports that have provided a shock absorber for our economy, for people's jobs, for people's incomes, for people's businesses, which has meant that in Australia, while the blow has been harsh compared to what has been seen in most other developed economies around the world, we've been able to mitigate a lot of that blow. But there are still difficult challenges ahead, both on a health front and certainly on an economic front. And one of the key challenges that we have been working through as a federal cabinet, as our cabinet together here with Makalia Cash, Senator Cash, but also in the national cabinet with all the state and territory leaders, has been the need to ensure that as we build back and through the COVID economic recession, that we are not only providing the economic supports for people to get through each day, but we're helping them to make the adjustments for the future. And a key part of that will be the training and skills that they will need to reskill, to upskill, and to get those initial skills as they're coming out of school to ensure that they can look for and find work, both in a COVID and post-COVID economy. Now, we know there are fewer jobs available for the number of people who are out there, and now is not a time to be standing idle. And so what we're announcing today is ensuring that there'll be additional support to ensure that those who are unable to get themselves into a new position, that we're providing the opportunity for them, like never before, to get greater access to skilling and training in the areas that they need to get that training, to find those jobs that will be prevalent in the COVID and the post-COVID economy. And so today we are making a very big commitment of some $2 billion in two particular areas to support the upskilling and reskilling of Australians. The first of those is something I flagged when I spoke at the press club many weeks ago, when I spoke of our JobMaker plan, and it had many components, and one of those was the skills that Australians need. And I flagged that we'd be seeking to move towards a new way of working with the states and territories to deliver on the skills that Australians who are looking to get a job and be trained for a job, and businesses who are looking for people to do those jobs. The way it's been done in the past, we don't believe, has been effective. We were prepared and are prepared to invest more, but in a better system. And what we're announcing today, with $500 million for investment this year, between now and the end of the financial year, starting at the beginning of September, is to create those places for Australians to get access to that vocational educational training right across the board, but particularly in those skills areas that the National Skills Commissioner has identified where there will be the greatest needs for those skills. It is sad and it is upsetting for many Australians that the industries and the places where they've been working, they will find it very difficult to find new employment in those sectors with those skills, potentially for some time. And so we want to ensure that they have the opportunity to make decisions so they can take on new skills and be able to find employment in other sectors potentially, so they can actually move forward with their own lives. Similarly, for businesses in those sectors, they will need skilled staff, and those businesses will need to rely on a system delivering greater levels of training. Now, it's not just for young people. It's worth pointing out that half of vet students are aged above 30. Half of those training in vocational education and training are aged over 30. And over 15% are aged over 50. So this program we're announcing today, $500 million from the Commonwealth, matched by the states and territories, this will mean training support for whatever stage of the labour market or your life cycle you're in. You may have been in a job for many years and you're now having to make a change. You may have been running your own business. You may have been a sole trader. You may have been doing something completely different. And one of the things I've been so encouraged by, despite the difficulty of the times, is I've gone around and I've spoken to people and I've heard their stories about the changes they've been making and the adjustments they've been making. Understanding the situation they're in, being honest about the reality of the situation they face, and making many difficult decisions about how they're going to make their way forward. Well, today's decision, today's announcement, working with the states and territories, is going to make those decisions that little bit more easier for them, knowing that they'll be getting the training and skills support that they will need. Now, the other decision we're making today is to extend the arrangements we have for apprentices. And that means that we've already supported some 80,000 apprentices in small businesses at a cost of some $1.3 billion. We are extending that now to small and medium-sized businesses, which means 180,000 apprentices we believe will be supported between now and the end of March. Now, that provides for a wage subsidy of up to $7,000, half of their wage, and that will be extended to small and medium-sized businesses, and that'll come at a cost between now and the end of March of some $1.5 billion. We're very determined to look ahead. And I'd say to Australians, as difficult as these times are, let's not look down. Let's look up. Let's lift our heads. Today's employment figure shows there is hope. Today's employment figure shows that we have done it before and we can do it again. We will continue to apply every resource we have available to ensure we get on top of the health situation with the virus in Victoria and supporting the many needs that are there and across the other states and territories. That is our absolute commitment. But equally, we need to ensure that we don't allow these setbacks to hold us back. Australians are incredibly resilient. And even as we go through these difficult times, let's lift our heads. Let's keep looking forward. Today's announcement on these skills supports are about looking forward to the jobs into the future and to ensure Australians can make the choices they need to get into those jobs by getting the training they need right now. Michaela.
Thank you, Prime Minister. And ladies and gentlemen, skills reform, as the Prime Minister has said, is a fundamental priority for the Morrison government. At the election in May last year, we took to the election a comprehensive agenda for skills reform in Australia that was endorsed by the Australian people. Since that time, I have been working cooperatively with my state and territory.
And that is where we will leave that announcement in Canberra. I'm now joined by our political reporter, Jonathan Kersley, for some analysis. Jono, this is an announcement very much looking to the future, isn't it?
Yeah, this was about really trying to retrain people. The Prime Minister does have an emphasis on trying to create jobs out the other side of this crisis. We saw that unemployment number rise to 7.4% today, with a fall in the number of people who were employed full-time. That is of significant concern, but the Prime Minister is also trying to remain positive. There was an increase overall in the number of people in jobs, and he's talking about this JobTrainer program, which will now be more than 340,000 training places, hopefully to start, the government says, in roundabout September. The key will be, though, reskilling these young people, whether then there is jobs for them out there, because coming out the other side of this crisis, it will be employment that will be a driving factor. We already see the real unemployment rate, if you like it. If you take away the JobKeeper program, which is subsidising the wages of some 3.5 million Australians, then the real unemployment rate is sitting round about 13.1%. So far higher than the 7.4 figure we're seeing today. It is masking the real number, but it is keeping people, as the government says, it is keeping them connected to their employer. But the Prime Minister also spoke there about, we've seen that the coronavirus has effectively shut down the economy in various states and cities right around the country. He's spoken about the need to keep those elements reopen. His wording was, don't allow setbacks to hold us back. He doesn't want to go back and forth in between shutting down parts of the economy, reopening them, because it's bad for the economy. It's also bad for the government, because it ultimately means that it will need to keep spending more money in support. But right now, the Prime Minister announcing today more than $2 billion to go towards training young people to try and upskill them for the years ahead. Lizzie?